One of the really effective ways that they built this system was that they created it so that it could accommodate new science. They knew that they couldn't know everything at the time. They'd have to put in placeholders for things that weren't going to work right. So they created this framework that is modular, so you can pull out pieces and plug in new pieces and really leverage new science as it becomes available. In 1978, they built upon that previous version of the model and added some more objective models that incorporate things like live fuel moisture and heavy dead fuel moisture to make the model more integrative. So the idea is that fire danger isn't really about the conditions today, it's about the conditions today and over the conditions over the last week or the last several weeks. So the ability to incorporate several weeks of information into a single rating for a day was a big step of forward progress. In 1988, Bob Bergen and others modified the fire danger rating system so that it would work better in the southeastern United States. But really what it did is identify the opportunities that or the need for this system to be generalized such that the same system can be applied across the entire country and it can be adapted locally, but really the core works anywhere. So that generalizable nature should carry on into the future, anything we do in the future. After 1978, we really focused primarily on the application of fire danger, and it remained essentially scientifically dormant for about four decades. But part of what we learned about that is how do you interpret these numbers? How do you use the numbers to define decision-making thresholds where we do something different once an energy release component exceeds a certain value? And all those things are really important. So these four concepts kind of form the core of what we need to keep in mind as we move forward. A lot's changed since 1972, 1978. In the early days, a fire danger rating was manually entered. So the observations were taken from shelters, manually recorded on paper, and hand calculated so that the indices could be communicated. There's a lot of new technology that's become available. Things like something as simple as solar power means we can have a weather station in a remote area that doesn't have traditional landline power, and it can relay that information. It does that by leveraging things like GPS and satellite telemetry, so we can send observations up and back down into a central database and have everything come into a central place. And that's the other piece that's really, really evolved since then is the information technology, the ability to use the internet and database management systems and the World Wide Web to really leverage how we get data into a central place and calculate fire danger indices and distribute those indices to users across the country. And then also the sensors are getting better, and then they're more available. So things like solar radiation sensors, which were not available in the early days, are now readily available for ROS stations and also a requirement for ROS stations. So after the National Fire Plan implementation in 2000, most ROS stations started putting solar radiation sensors on in preparation for this National Fire Danger Rating System update. We couldn't do very much until we had enough data from those sensors. So it took at least a decade before we could even think about transitioning over to use something different. Other things have changed as well. So the applications themselves have improved. So fire danger applications in the late 1980s when Pat Andrews and others started exploring linkages between fire danger and fire business activities were very primitive. And now they've evolved a lot into our new tools like Fire Family Plus for being able to explore historical variations in fire danger and their association with fire activity. We know that lots of things have improved in terms of how we model fuel moistures. And then also our understanding of fire danger applications or best practices have really improved in the ability to incorporate or to consolidate all of this information into a fire danger operating plan or some type of plan that says how we use fire danger on a local unit has evolved a lot since the 70s. And then also the need for this information to really inform firefighter safety and situational awareness. As we learn more, we find more and more occasions where the fire danger becomes a critical tool for understanding how conditions today are different than yesterday or previous. So these lessons learned provide the foundation for how we move forward. So one of the ways we move forward is by maintaining that modularity or leveraging that modularity. So we know that things like the fuel moisture models in NFDRS are separate or isolated from the way the indexes are calculated, which means we can pull a fuel moisture model out, replace it with a better one, and as long as they generate the same outputs, so the same fuel moisture outputs, they can be plugged right into the index calculations without changing any structure of the system at all. So that's how we were able to move forward with NFDRS 2016, is leveraging that modular approach. We know we want to keep that integrative nature of fire danger because we know that some of the things that really work about fire danger are things like the 1,000-hour fuel moistures. The 1,000-hour fuel moistures tell you not what the weather is today or what it was yesterday, but how it's been over the last few weeks, or how it's been trending over the last few weeks. So having that multiple time horizons of today and where you are within the season and how do you compare between years is really a critical piece. And the whole idea of generalized, of being generalized means that we want the same system to perform equally across any part of this country. Basically, the same system should work everywhere. That's hard, but it's not impossible. It just means that we have to sometimes make simplifying assumptions that might not be absolutely perfect for a particular place to maintain the generality of the system across the whole domain that we're interested in, which is the entire United States. And then the last part is the applicable part, is how do we've learned a lot about what the numbers mean. We know that an individual energy release component value, a raw value, is only relevant for the place it's calculated. So an ERC of 52 doesn't mean the same thing in the southeastern United States that it means in the southwestern United States. So we have to normalize those scales in some meaningful way, usually by converting to percentiles, to really be able to either compare between places or even to communicate how fire danger is changing over time within a local unit. So really moving all of this leads us back to the idea of having a common language that's built on the best available science that we can apply across all agencies, and the agencies themselves can determine how best to leverage that information. One of the things that Harry Gisborne said in 1948 is that our danger measuring system may have its weak spots, but the best watch in the world will not show time accurately if you don't wind it. Well, that basically he's saying that you have to keep the system up. You have to maintain the system. You have to understand and keep the watch working well. But sometimes maybe you need to build a better watch. And essentially that's what we've done here, is try to move towards building a better watch where the same logic applies.